The Mighty Brain presents The Ring of Fire, The Doomsday Clock, Extended Edition. Around the Pacific Ocean, there's a huge natural wonder called the Ring of Fire. This ring, which is actually a horseshoe-shaped belt of volcanoes, has about 200 volcanoes. Some are single volcanoes, and some are groups of volcanoes. It's one of the most active and complicated areas on Earth when it comes to geology. The huge plates of the Earth's crust that meet here create a lot of pressure. This pressure is released as earthquakes, shifts in the Earth's crust, and volcanoes erupting. But what if this ring is more than just a cool geological feature? What if it has a purpose that goes beyond just what we can see and touch? Like a natural clock, moving in a steady rhythm? A system that doesn't just release molten rock, but something much deeper, much older. From a scientific point of view, the Ring of Fire is formed by something called subduction. Ocean plates slide under land plates and melt into the Earth's hot middle layer. The molten rock then pushes up through the Earth's crust, creating volcanoes. But the way these volcanoes are spread out, almost in a perfect circle around the Pacific, is surprisingly neat. It's almost as if they have a deeper, maybe even planned arrangement. Chapter 2. The Volcanic Clock, The Secret of the Cycle. In recent years, scientists have noticed that volcanic eruptions around the Ring of Fire often happen in a repeating pattern. The energy from earthquakes seems to move clockwise along the lines where the Earth's plates meet. It often starts in Central and South America, then moves across the South Pacific to Asia, continues to Russia, then Alaska, and the west coast of North America before coming back to South America. Each eruption seems to be part of a sequence, like an invisible hand moving across a volcanic clock face. This discovery completely changes how we understand volcanic eruptions. Instead of messy, separate events, they now look like a connected chain. One event seems to affect the next. Earthquake waves traveling along the Pacific plate boundaries could be the trigger. The rocks are weakened by earlier quakes, the pressure changes, and one volcano after another starts to wake up. This idea of a volcanic clock brings a new sense of order to what seemed like chaos. It shows a logic in the Earth's plates that we hadn't seen before. And it makes us wonder, where will the clock hand move next? Chapter 3. Yellowstone, the center of the ring. Geographically, the Yellowstone-Supervulkan isn't directly on the Ring of Fire. But in a symbolic way, it's at its heart. Like the center of a clock, it sits in the middle of a huge earthquake cycle. Yellowstone isn't a normal volcano, it's a supervolcano. A sleeping giant with a magma chamber that stretches for hundreds of miles. If Yellowstone were to erupt, it wouldn't just be a local event, but a global one. The last big eruptions of this volcano happened over 600,000 years ago. But even today, Yellowstone shows strange things happening. The ground is rising. Hot springs are getting hotter. Tiny earthquakes are happening. The Earth is alive and it breathes. What if the Ring of Fire is like an engine? And Yellowstone is the end point. If we think of the Ring of Fire as a clock, then Yellowstone is the center where all the energy gathers. Maybe it's the place where all the tension meets. And maybe it's also the last door to open. Chapter 4, The Fallen Angels, Myth as Metaphor. In the old writings of the Book of Enoch and the Bible letters of Peter and Jude, there's talk of fallen angels. Beings who went against heaven and were thrown deep into the earth. How many? 200. They were chained in dark pits. In geology, we talk about roughly 200 mapped volcanoes along the ring. Coincidence? Or is there a deeper, symbolic meaning behind it? What if each of these volcanoes is a seal? A kind of prison where an ancient being is held captive? Every eruption would then not just be a geological event, but a spiritual one. The earth opens its wound, and something old, something banished, rises. The smoke, the shaking, the fire, all of it would be signs of a seal breaking. And what if 199 of these seals have already broken? What if only one remains? Would it be Yellowstone? Chapter 5. The Signs of the Times. What the World is Telling Us. Old prophecies say that in the last days, big earthquakes, fire and smoke will shake the earth. The book of Revelation talks about lightning, thunder, smoke, and an earthquake like never before. In the prophecy of Joel, it says that people will have dreams and visions. And all over the world, people are reporting strange dreams, strong feelings that something is coming, and a spiritual awakening. At the same time, we're seeing strange physical things too. Animals acting strangely before earthquakes. The Earth's magnetic field suddenly changing. More cosmic rays, which could affect the Earth's core temperature. Sudden changes in the air, in earthquake waves, in heat from underground. Maybe these are the Earth's signs. Maybe it's a call. Or a countdown. If you follow the clockwise movement of the last eruptions, the earthquake energy is currently moving towards North America. Mount Rainier. Mount St. Helens. The Pacific Northwest. And then, Yellowstone. Revelation talks about a fallen star that comes to Earth and is given the key to the abyss. It opens it, and smoke rises like from a giant furnace. From this smoke, beings emerge. The angel over these beings is called Abaddon, the destroyer. The similarity to a supervolcano eruption is striking. Smoke, darkness, a sudden opening. What if these verses aren't just symbols? What if they point to real, geological events? If Yellowstone erupts, it wouldn't just be a physical event. It would be a break in the balance. The ring would be fully active. The clock would have struck its last chime. From a spiritual point of view, the ring of fire could be a prison. The volcanoes wouldn't just be mountains, they would be gates, locks to a deeper world. Places where energy is held captive, where consciousness is trapped. In many old cultures, volcanoes were considered sacred, homes of gods or demons. In Hawaii, for example, the Kilauea volcano is linked to the fire goddess Pele. In Japan, Mount Fuji is linked to Shinto spirits. Maybe these cultures were right. Maybe every volcano is a cell in a worldwide prison. And when the cells break open one by one, when fire and smoke rise, it's not just geology. Then it's freedom. Today's science can explain a lot. And yet questions remain. Why this increase in earthquake activity right now? Why this striking order? Why does it match up with ancient prophecies? Maybe we're moving towards a threshold. A point where science and myth, physics and spirituality, matter and spirit touch. A moment when the curtain lifts and we realize that the world is more than just a ball of rock. The ring of fire is speaking to us. With every eruption, with every tremor, it says, the clock is ticking. Yellowstone is sleeping, but it's listening. It feels every movement on the edge of the ring, every tremor, every fire that rises. And maybe it's waiting for the final push, the final strike. When that comes, maybe not only the earth will open, but also heaven. Maybe then it will be time. The last seal breaks, and time, as we know it, ends. The ring is closed. The cycle is complete. And what rises from the deep is older than any mountain. And maybe everything we've seen so far was just the beginning. Chapter 6, Legends of Fire. Over thousands of years, long before we had words like seismology or plate tectonics, ancient cultures told stories of fire, chaos, and worlds beneath our feet. These myths, spread across continents, all share similar ideas. Rings of fire. Trapped gods or monsters and a final showdown that would change everything. In Polynesian legends, the goddess Pele lives in Kalauea, and her anger bursts forth in rivers of molten rock. She is both a creator and a destroyer, a power whose waking brings big changes. The ground shakes, the sky turns dark, and her fiery dance is seen as a sign that the line between worlds is thin. If you go to the Norse sagas, you find Surtur, the giant with the flaming sword, who is meant to break free from the underworld in Ragnarok, the end of all things, from the underworld. Surtur's fire swallows the world, echoing the scary visions of volcanic disasters, where earth and sky are eaten by flames. In Japan, Mount Fuji is not just a mountain, but a gateway. Legends speak of spirits and gods sealed beneath it, their power kept in check by rituals and respect. An eruption isn't just geology, it's a prison breaking open, a warning that the balance is changing. Mesoamerican myths tell of Xibalba, the Mayan underworld, entered through caves and fiery cracks. Here gods and monsters live, and the earth itself is alive with restless spirits. The Aztecs believed in a world that went in cycles, destroyed and reborn by fire and shaking earth. Even in the ancient Mediterranean, the Greeks spoke of Typhon, a monstrous force buried under Mount Etna. When the giant stirs, the volcano roars. A myth that gives feelings and purpose to earthquake activity. These stories, separated by oceans and centuries, come together on the same ideas. Rings or chains of fire, forces sealed underground, and disasters that mark the end of one age and the start of a new one. Are these just stories, or did our ancestors feel a deeper truth in the rhythms of the land? The Ring of Fire, with its 200 volcanoes and its regular awakenings, becomes more than just a geological feature. It's the modern echo of old fears and predictions, a living myth that shows up again and again in ash. Maybe science, as it figures out the Earth's patterns, isn't just finding physical processes, but the very stories people have always told. Of beginnings, endings, and the fires that connect them all. Chapter 7, Yellowstone Awakens, the day the supervolcano erupts. Imagine this. Deep beneath Wyoming's forests and hot springs, the earth begins to tremble. At first, just slight tremors, barely more than a whisper. But in the coming days, they grow into a rumble, accompanied by a visible bulging of the ground. Scientists at this stage speak of a magma chamber filling and pushing upwards. Then the first phase begins, a massive swarm of earthquakes. These quakes move like a wave across Yellowstone National Park. They are a sign that immense pressure is building beneath the surface. Shortly thereafter, the second phase occurs, the explosion of the rock cap. With unimaginable force, the Earth's crust breaks open, rock fragments are hurled for miles. A gigantic eruption shoots magma, ash, and gas tens of thousands of meters high into the atmosphere. The sky darkens within minutes. The third phase is the ash catastrophe. Ashfall begins to spread, first over Wyoming, Montana, and Idaho. Within hours, cities like Billings, Salt Lake City, and Denver are buried under a meter-thick layer of ash. Within days, the fine particles reach Chicago, St. Louis, and even New York on the East Coast. Air traffic over North America comes to a complete standstill. But that's just the beginning. The fourth phase brings global climate change. The enormous amounts of sulfur dioxide hurled into the stratosphere form a reflective layer. Sunlight is blocked, temperatures drop worldwide. Scientists speak of a volcanic winter. In North America, temperatures could drop by several degrees, with drastic consequences for agriculture and water supply. In the fifth phase, the catastrophe expands globally. Ash clouds reach Europe and Asia, air routes over the Atlantic and Pacific are closed. crops fail, famines arise, markets and supply chains collapse. Particularly affected would be North America, entire USA, Canada, Mexico. Ashfall, power outages, infrastructure collapse. Europe, a few weeks later, temperature drop, crop failures. Asia and Africa, decline in monsoons and droughts. Worldwide, a multi-year volcanic winter changes life on Earth. The finale of this chain, the collapse of the Yellowstone caldera. After the massive eruption, the Earth's crust collapses, a giant crater remains, a witness to one of the greatest natural disasters in human history. And yet, as apocalyptic as this idea sounds, it is also a window into the Earth's forces. Forces that we cannot control, but which show us that our planet is a living, breathing entity.